श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परम ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। There are many topics in our scriptures. And these topics have a purpose. And if we are able to understand why a particular topic is given, like, you know, in gross understanding, there is one topic about creation, and there are dozens of theories of creation, not one. And when we read those dozens of theories of creation, we get confused, and then we say, oh, it's all confused thing. See, so what is the purpose of giving these theories of creation? This we have to understand. Then the second topic comes, the topic of karma, the last life, this life, next life, sin, merit, going to hell, going to heaven, rebirth. All these topics have some purpose. If that purpose is not understood, we get lost. Then the third topic comes, the topic of glorifying the great Mahatmas. Like in Bhagavad Gita, because you all are well versed, there are three chapters where this topic is taken, the glorification of or the description of the wise people. In the second chapter, Bhagavan Krishna talks about the Sthita Pragya Lakshana. In the 12th chapter, he talks about the qualities of a devotee. And in the 14th chapter, he talks about a man who has transcended the limitations of the Prakriti or the three gunas. Now, these topics are meant for what? See, are we going to evaluate the wise people? So we read in Bhagavad Gita, for example, that prajahati yada kaman sarvan parthamanogatan atmanne vatmana tushtaha sthita prajna sadochate dukkeshu anudvignamanaha sukheshu vigatasprahaha vitaraga bhayakrodaha sthitadihi muni uchate. Now, when these topics we read in Bhagavad Gita, do we go that as a reference point and start evaluating the people? Oh, he is not realized. He seems to be realized. Maybe 30% realize. No. What for these topics are? Similarly, the topic of Jivan Mukta. The Jivan Mukta topic is not for we should attain Jivan Mukti. That is not the goal. See, friends, Jivan Mukta means what? Liberated while alive. So for this, the basic requirement is we have to accept we are in bondage while alive. So the question is, are we feeling any bondage? We are perfectly all right. Where is the bondage? See? Therefore, what exactly is this? This is the main theme that we will think about. This topic of Bhagwan Ramachandra to be a Jivan Mukta is exhaustively dealt with in Yoga Vasishta. Yoga Vasishta is a huge book, 32,000 verses. So even if you want to read it, your breathing will be out. So, there are two places these instructions are accepted in our scriptures as the books of authority. One is Bhagavad Gita and second is Yoga Vasishtha. Bhagavad Gita was told to Arjun when the house was on fire. See? Arjuna was on the battlefield and that very moment he got so confused and deluded that he was unable to perform what he was supposed to do. So there Arjun was confused. He was an ordinary person, a warrior, and the one who gave instruction is Bhagwan Sri Krishna, the incarnation of Paramatma. One scenario. The second scenario comes in Yoga Vasishtha. Here the disciple Rama himself is the incarnation of God. See, he was not ordinary like Arjuna. And Arjuna was given the instruction at the age of 86. See? Bhagwan Ramakrishna was instructed at the age of 15. See the difference? And why this particular situation came? This is the theme. Bhagwan Ram, as we all know, belonged to the solar dynasty, son of Dashrath. And everything was perfectly all right. Like a prince, he was leading a very comfortable life. Then he decided that simply sitting in the palace, what will I do? Let me see the world. This is one of the most important spiritual practice, which Arjuna did not do. Bhagwan Ram did. The spiritual practice is, he went to many holy places and saw the world. When we go to the holy places, normally we see only the buildings, the rivers, the cleanliness, and where good food is available. Beyond that, nothing. One person somewhere from USA asked me this question, Swamiji, had you been to Haridwar? I said, yes. What do you have seen there? I said, are you taking my examination or what? No, I just want to know, have you seen Paratha Galli? I said, no. Then you have seen nothing. If you go to Haridwar and don't eat paratha, then what for you are gone? Look here. So when we go to the holy places, visiting holy places is fulfilled if you have satsang attended in those places. See, friends. So Bhagwan Ramachandra ji moved to so many places throughout India, maybe for a year or so. And thereafter, when he came back, he went to his own palace and he was staying. And slowly he started withdrawing. See? And that one day, it so happens, Vishwamitra ji comes to Dasharath ji and asks a request. When Vishwamitra, the great sage, comes, the king Dasharatha is very happy. He is received with all pomp and show. And therefore, sir, what can I do for you? You just ask, it is done. And Dasharatha ji was stunned when he came to know that Vishwamitra ji has come to ask for Rama and Lakshmana to protect his yajna, because the Rakshasas were, terrorists were that time also. They were coming and destroying the yajna. See? So he said, I want somebody to protect security guards. So I want to take your sons because I trust them. They are capable. When this was said, Dasharatha was totally broken. He said, no, 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 you ask me anything, I can't give you. He even doesn't have mustaches on his face. He is hardly 15 years of age. Such a small child, what he will do? If you want, I'll come with you with all my armor and protect your yagya. So when this was said, Vasishthaji was there. And Vasishthaji says, O king, this is wrong. Once you have said, you ask and things are done. Now you can't go back. See, you must respect your words. If you don't respect your words, nobody will respect you in life. Therefore, that is the reason why our children don't listen to us. Because we don't listen to ourselves. So how the children will listen? How we don't listen to ourselves? We all know, early to bed and early to rise. But do we listen to that? See, friends. So, Dasharatha ji was convinced and, okay, I shall send Rama and Lakshmana with you. Then a messenger comes that very time. This is how you know all our scriptures. You take Puranas, Mahabharata, Ramayana, Yoga Vasishta, everywhere. It is better than any Hindi cinema plots. Perfectly done. So when this thing was going on, at that very moment, the messenger comes in that big assembly of people. And he says, sir, yes, something has happened to Rama. We don't know what happened to him. He is not eating. He is not even taking bath. He is totally lost. He is not even doing his japa. He is not talking to anybody. He is not interested in anything. We don't know what happened to him. He has run down only bone and skin. We don't know what happened to him. He doesn't want to talk to anybody. When all the comforts are available to him, he doesn't allow anybody to come to his chamber. He is completely broken, withdrawn. We don't know. We are very much worried, sir. What should we do? So Dasharatha said, please call him here. So Bhagwan Rama comes. And after he comes, then the first chapter of Yoga Vasishtha tells what was the thought process that was going on in the mind of Bhagwan Ramachandra at the age of 15. He has moved around and underlined. He learned from every interaction in his life. Friends, spiritual practice begins and it never ends. When we have taken a vow to learn from our experiences, our every experience is our guru. Don't run here and there in search of a guru. Learn from your own experience. And when we learn from the experience, be very attentive. No impressions are made on the mind. This is a basic thing about spiritual practice. Our day-to-day life is what? When we interact with the world, normally we react. Our interaction is in the form of reaction. And whenever we react, there are one of the two impressions formed on our mind. Either we like something or we dislike something. Because it's a reaction. See? And these likes and dislikes are common. Whether you like food, you like a person, you like a place, you like a job, anything. The liking is common. Similarly, dislike is common. And with every experience, every interaction, when we start reacting, the likes and dislikes become so deep in our system that after some time, as the age grows, these two, earlier there were two lines, two dots of likes and dislikes. With the passage of age, these two dots become lines, the lines become furrows. The furrows become valleys, and thereafter Our life is nothing but what I like, I will do that. Whether it is right or wrong, we don't care. See, friend, because the basic thing, we have not learned from our experiences of life. So the real spiritual practice Bhagwan Ramachandra started when he went on the pilgrimage. He learned. See, my friends, one common example which we all know, in our childhood, sometime or the other, we have touched the fire. Whichever way, either candle or something, our hand got burned. So we learned, fire burns. And therefore, we have no like or dislike for the fire. On the contrary, that burning ability of the fire is encashed by us by knowing how to interact with the fire. We don't have likes and dislikes because we have learned. Now apply the same principle in life. The problem is we don't learn. This is the difference between Bhagwan Rama and you and me. We don't learn. Real spiritual practice begins with this. Learn. See? One or two examples I'll give you. Learning means what? I was in Bombay and with my friend, and he had a daughter about 8 or 9 years. Very cute, very sweet. Children are sweet when they are small. Even the donkey's babies are sweet. So, when we are going out, me and my friend, for some work, so I don't like peace at home. I like chaos. I like confusion. See, then you can never be miserable. If you like everything perfect, you will be perfectly miserable. Because you are a perfectionist. So, what to do in that house? So I thought, you know, before going, I should play some trick. So I went to her. I said, hey, we are going. Don't you ask your dad to get something? Ask him something, chocolate, etc. We'll get for you. Okay, Swamiji. She didn't argue. Wise people don't argue. So she went. Dad, in the evening when you come back, please get me a nice big chocolate bar, okay? Okay, darling. We went away. Evening we came back. And I know he has not purchased. So, after entering the house, I went to her room. I said, hey, see, your dad has bought something for you. So, with that all enthusiasm, she went. Daddy, my chocolate? Oh, God, I have forgotten. Tomorrow, I'll get for you. And that time, I expected explosion. Nothing happened. I was a total failure. She coolly came back. Then I said, my God, what is wrong with me? Where did I go wrong? So I asked her, I said, hey, your daddy didn't bring chocolate for you. Didn't you feel bad about it? He said, no. So why? Well, I have given 100% discount to whatever my father says. He never does what he says. Imagine, the small child has learned. Whatever my dad says, he never does. Therefore, if he brings it, then it is a surprise. If he has not brought it, it is natural. See, friends, if we learn from the experiences of our life, we don't have to go anywhere. Because every experience is our guru. If we can't learn from our experiences, even God cannot teach us. Learn. This is where the Jivan Mukti of Bhagwan Ramachandra started. See, he visited so many places. And after having come home, all whatever he has learned, he started reflecting on that. And there are huge, long chapter pages together. And he starts one by one. He says, we are all so much identified with the body. Whole life is spent only maintaining the body and decorating the body, having comforts for the body, getting indulged into the ahara nidra bhaya maithunancha, procreation, indulgence, drinking and moving around and decorating our bodies. Other than that, what we have achieved through this body? Is this the purpose that the body is for us? And this body, in its childhood, is so cute, then it starts growing. As it starts growing, it starts developing different personalities. And in the old age, nobody wants that person. He is all alone, full of diseases and all that. So this body, we are living only for body? No. Something is wrong. It is not the right way. Then he takes another wealth. So many people have collected so much of wealth, but money has never given happiness to anybody. On the contrary, money gives more problems. Bhagavan Shankara says, artham anartham bhavaya nityam nasti tataha sukha lesha satyam putradapi dhana bhajam bhiti sarvatraisha vihitariti. Earning money is problematic. Protecting the earned money is more problematic. And disbursement of the money to other people is the most painful thing. And our whole life we are spending only for that money. And see the funny part. Money is in the bank. You have got only either credit card or your passbook. And looking at it, oh, I got 10 million. That money is devalued. Like in India, people had billions and billions in cash, everything overnight over. See, friends. And thus, the body, the age, the money, the nears and dears, we keep on creating relations in this world. That this is like my friend, my enemy, and whole life is thus consolidated only in the form of two things. I am just summarizing this huge chapters, more than 30-40 chapters. He says, our whole body is consolidated in the form of possessions and relations. When we are identified with our body, we get lost only in possessions and protection of those possessions. And when we are identified with our own mind, we are lost in relations, maintaining or destroying the relations. See? Just watch, this is the best way of spiritual practice. This is how you know how these people fall in love and get hurt. That hurting is called as marriage. So, the mind tells, oh, she is so beautiful, he is so handsome, we are made for each other. The same mind tells. See? So they get married. So after that, instead of made for each other, they start mad at each other. And then, because of you, I cannot survive. Then the same mind tells, separate, divorce. This mind is making us dance, and yet we don't understand this. Therefore, the world, our body, the mind is the one which is making us dance like mad, and yet we are not learning from our own experiences of life. Thus, Bhagavan Ramachandra gives a very long discourse in the assembly of all the people. Dasharathji Maharaj, then Vasishthaji, then Vishwamitraji, and all the wise people, that 15-year child, he goes on telling other. After his discourse is over, all of them glorify, bravo, great indeed, sadhu, you have really thought over a great way. You are the wiser than the wisest. There is nothing more for you to be known. Then where is the problem? See, friends, exactly the same situation comes in Kathopanishad. Same situation. There, Nachiket approaches the Lord Death. In his first two boons, he asks something good for his father. Then he asks that Swarga Vidya, wherein one can go to heavens by doing the yajna, etc. And the third boon he asks, and if you hear his third boon, he has analyzed perfectly well, and yet there is something missing in that. His boon ask was, Anyatra dharmat, anyatra adharmat, anyatra asmat kruta krutat, anyatra bhutat cha bhavyat cha, yat tat pashyasi tadvada. O Lord, tell me that which is beyond the limitations of dharma adharma, beyond the limitations of cause and effect, beyond the limitation of time, past, present and future, and that what you are seeing, that you show me. For the surface swimmer, it will appear as if Nachiket knew everything. Exactly the same way, Bhagwan Ramachandra, he gave such a lovely discourse, and yet there was something missing that time in him. See? And at the conclusion of his long discourse, he says, having contemplated upon on this world and worldly ways, I don't wish to live. I just don't want to live. I just want to leave this world. I just want to end my life. See? Friends, there is a hairline difference between dispassion and depression. In both the cases, depression as well as dispassion, there is withdrawal from the world. See? A person who is under depression is unhealthy condition of the mind. A person who is having dispassion is the healthy condition of the mind. This is a Jivan Mukta. The one who is established in this dispassion, not depression, living in that mode 24/7 is being a Jivan Mukta. See? And a Jivan Mukta liberated while alive is a Mahatma who is living in meditation. He never does meditation. He is living in meditation. See, friends. And the sign of the wise man are his wisdom is steady. We get lost only in the steady body. When we sit for meditation, pillow here, pillow there, pillow under. And then, see, I was in Germany at a 2-3 days meditation camp in Hamburg or somewhere. That was my first time. And in Germany there is no water, only beer. So after our morning meditation class over, then we had some snacks, then we had one more lecture after that. And then we had a break, we went for a long walk and all that, came back. And then after that I said, you know, I won't eat today, I am all right, you can continue, I'll go for a walk lately. So those people ate and everything, I came for the next lecture. There were about more than a dozen or two beer bottles empty kept there. And I was talking on something, and all of them were having Shambhavi Mudra. See? Liquid spirituality. Not solid one. See, friends. steadiness of wisdom, not the steadiness of body. No. Body may be moving, mind may be working, and yet the wisdom never gets corrupted. Is it possible or theoretical? Like Bhagavan Krishna tells in reply to Arjuna's question, what is the meaning of meditation for a man of steady wisdom? So the meaning of meditation is, he doesn't do meditation first of all, but he lives in meditation. A Jivan Mukta Purusha is the one who is living in meditation. He doesn't do meditation. See? Now what is living in meditation? Only two things, not third. First is, Prajahati Yada Kaman Sarvan Partha Manogatan. Hey Arjun, when all the desires from our mind are deleted for good, living at a zero desire level, what is the meaning of living at zero desire level? Living at zero complaint level. See, no complaint about anything. Then our mind will stop reacting. Complaint is nothing but a reaction of the mind. And these come only from our likes and dislike pressure. Suppose I like punctuality. So, what is in my hands? I should be punctual. Whether others should be punctual or not, is it in my hand? No. Net result, I'll be frustrated. See? Recently, where it happened, I used to switch off your phones, but every time the phone will ring. Then in one talk before beginning, I said, please switch on your phones. And that day not a single phone rang. So that day I understood, you have to tell ulta, then the people believe. See friends, this is how the world is. Our attention should be attentive at our peace of mind. Nothing in this world is more valuable than our peace of mind. Let the whole world be on fire. Our peace of mind should not be corrupted. See, friends. So, why the peace of mind is disturbed? Because, kaman, there are so many expectations, so many desires, so much pressure of likes and dislikes. And because of that, the mind is disturbed. See? And this is what we go when we go in the temple and ask before the Lord. We tell Lord the following thing should happen. Complain. When it is winter, we complain, oh, it is cold. Naturally, winter has to be cold. When it is summer, we complain, it's too hot. The poor Lord, what will he do? Anything we do, we complain. Therefore, he never listens to our complaints. Because when somebody is constantly complaining, we don't give value to that, isn't it? Before listening, this is what I do. Before listening, I say, yes, yes, yes. I don't have to think about it. It's all useless. When you go and talk about your problem to somebody for the first time, that buddy will do a mistake and listen to you. And because it is his mistake, why did he listen? You get inspired. Next time again you go, see, last time I told you, but something I forgot. I will tell you again. Is it a Ramayana or what? Again the same useless things. Friends, mind must be at peace. The one whose mind is at peace under all conditions, he is Jivan Mukta. See, don't you see in the story of Ramayana, he was offered the throne. He was not jumping out of his skin. I'm going to be... No, he was cool. And next moment, it was taken away. He did not become angry, frustrated. See, friends, not only that, then he was sent to the forest He had no ill feeling towards Kausalya or anybody. See, Fred, Lakshmana was angry. Ram was not angry. See, my friends, wisdom is to be maintained. And what is the wisdom? Number one, the one who becomes disturbed because of others is a fool of the highest order. One place, on some airport, one person asked me this question. Youngster, maybe mid-20s or 30s, he says, Swamiji, I am your fan, I always listen to you on YouTube. I said, you are telling lies. He said, no, promise, I really listen. I said, if you are my fan, why don't you keep moving? Stationary fuse fan, I guess. Then he said, I want to ask you a question. I said, okay, what is the question? Question is, you are constantly moving around the world, giving talks to every place, everywhere, but people don't change. Don't you feel disgusted? See? I said, do you know basic principles of life? Our prayer is totally different than your prayer. Your prayer is Bhagwan, before Bhagwan, Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramayaha, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhuyat. Our prayer is different. Sarve Bhavantu Ajnaninaha, Sarve Bhavantu Roginaha. Then only they will come to us. We don't want the people to improve. We don't want the people to change. If they will improve and change, where will I go? My market will be gone. Friends, spiritual practice is focusing our attention on ourselves, not on the world. We have not created this world. Why we should worry? Take care of yourself. See? And this is what Bhagwan Rama did. He did not react with anyone. Whether it was Dasharathji, whether it was Kausalya or Kaikeyi or Manthara, for him, name dveshosti na priya. See. And the reason being, prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan. He had no plans, no projects of his own, what I have to do in this world. No. Relax. See? This principle I have been following from these great examples in life. Therefore, where I had to stay, I don't think Arvind is taking care. Why worry? Which flight we have to go, I don't worry. Somebody has done. Who will wash my clothes? I don't worry. Who will iron them? I don't worry. What food I have to eat? I don't worry. The less you think, wiser you are. Stop thinking. As in deep sleep. We don't think. The moment you stop thinking, you are happy. When you are happy, you laugh. Thinking and laughing cannot go together. Those who think, they cannot laugh. Those who laugh, they don't think. Try to think and laugh. You cannot. Prajahati yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan. And second thing is, atmanne vatmana tushtaha. One is at peace with oneself. Atmanne vatmana tushtaha. A Jivan Mukta Purush, he is at peace with himself as Bhagwan Ramachandra was. See, when Ravana was killed, that time Bhagwan Ram tells Lakshman and Vibhishan, kindly go and do all the rites. As much he is brother to Vibhishana, he is equally brother to you. Hey Lakshmana, go and do it. After death, enmity ends. See, it is not after killing somebody, then behead and cut his body into pieces. That is not the way. Because that bitterness is not there. It is something like when a doctor is doing the operation, he has to cut the body and blood comes out, everything is done. But that time he doesn't have bitterness, achcha ho gaya, cut over. No. Atmanne vatmana tushtaha. These lakshanas, these lifestyle factors were abundantly demonstrated by Bhagwan Ram throughout his life, because before he started his life, from the age of 15 onwards, before that, Bhagwan Vasishtaji gave him the highest knowledge. So before jumping into the life, he had this wisdom at his disposal. This was lacking for Arjun. See the difference. Arjuna led a life of vengeance, fighting, proving something. See? Then in exile, Arjuna was also in exile, Bhagwan Rama was also in exile. See the difference? Because Arjuna, during his exile in the forest, he did not do any tapasya for realization, only collecting more and more missiles so that he can kill and destroy the Kauravas. But Bhagwan Ramachandra was 14 years in the forest, but never he had any bitterness, because he had no desires and he was at peace with himself. If we are real devotees of Bhagwan Ram, see, when your mind gets disturbed, remember this. The difficulties that Rama has gone through were necessary for all of us to learn. He demonstrated life is possible in spite of all the difficulties, without becoming bitter about life. See, friends. Atmanne vatmana tushtaha. Now the question comes, what is that because of which Bhagavan Rama was so much at peace with himself? See? How can he attain equanimity? He had no bitterness towards Ravana. See, even after going to the Lanka, he had sent that Angad, go and try to pacify him. Let us not have this fight. But he didn't agree. Ravana didn't agree. Till the last moment, he was at peace. Be attentive. But this ahimsa, ahimsa, ahimsa should not be glorified beyond limits. Many people glorify ahimsa beyond limit and then they get destroyed. No. See, friends, we should talk the language what the people understand. See, talking to a cruel person with love will not help. And therefore, Bhagwan Rama killed Ravana, be attentive, without bitterness. It was kind of an operation. It was necessary for his evolution. See? Therefore, this equanimity of the mind, is it ever possible to be discovered and practiced by us in our life? For that we have to know different types of equanimities which are possible and which should be practiced. First equanimity is at the gross level, when we are all living together, we take this world as real, we take our body as real. This is called a vivahara. Vivahara is that we have to conduct the business of life. There, Bhagavan Krishna says, Vidya vinaya sampanne brahmane gavihastini shuni chaiva swapa kecha panditaha samadarshinaha. The first kind of equanimity is, do not see, promote, and establish differences. Discover a common factor. On the basis of that common factor, we can get united and lead happily, cheerful life. See? Like you are here, so much far away from India. All of you are different from each other. You have got different problems. Everything is different. Yet, there is a common denominator. What is that? You are all good Jews. There was one WhatsApp I received from India. Prime Minister is a good Jew. Then the President of the BJP is a good Jew. The Governor of the Reserve Bank is a good Jew. The richest man in India is a good Jew. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, good Jew, good Jew, good Jew, good Jew, good Jew. Therefore, the whole nation is having a garba. Common denominator. See the common factor. Don't see the differences. When we develop this vision, then alone we are leading a life of equanimity. See, friend, differences are necessary for conducting the business of life. But doesn't mean we should have differentiation. See? Like, you know, it's okay, you should love everybody. But if it is a dog, dog should be treated only as a dog. Don't give your mouth to him and then pat, pat, pat. No, 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 no. Don't sleep with the animals all the time. Without the dog, I can't sleep. Next life, you will be a dog. Don't worry. Friends, it's okay. We must have clear understanding. So this is regarding the conduct. When we take this world and everything to be real, how do we keep the mind equanimous? Number one. Number two, equanimity also comes on the basis of our experiences. How we take our experiences? Do we give too much importance to our own whims and fancy? Or we are able to understand others and tolerate others? Tolerance is an expression of equanimity. See? One day, someplace I was there, they were asking me, Swamiji, you go to so many houses and so many places, so many different foods, so many different things. How do you manage? I said, tolerate. What else can you do? Every place you don't get all the things that they are right or you want nothing. Then, be attentive. Very simple rule which I have followed, you try to follow. Start counting down. When I came to South Africa, I started with 20, 19, 18, 17, 16. Now today it is 1. Tomorrow 1 over. Day after tomorrow. Be attentive. When I know that I have to go from here, will I get lost in friends and enemies? No. Will I try to improve anybody? No. I know I have to go from here. Why create friends and enemies? No. The more we become aware of this fact, we are in this world for a vacation. We are not here for the eternity. Like we had a camp. I don't know the name of the place. The spelling goes to 38 letters. By the time I pronounce it, my tongue falls down. Horrible. See? So when we went there, we know that we are there only for 2 nights and 2 days. That's it. So you are not going to hold on to all these things exactly the same way. We are here for a short period of time. See? But we start imagining that here we are for eternity. See? By this, equanimity can be attained. Now third and the most important equanimity. Find out a common factor. common factor is we are all alive. Common factor. And when we are merging with that principle of life, presently we are living as individuals. Instead of living as individuals, if we practice to live as life, see what happens. One story I will tell you. This story I like very much. This is from the life story of Shirdi Sai Baba. You might have heard the name, Shirdi Sai Baba. Once he was in his masjid sitting, and one of his devotees, those days, something like 1895 that time. So, she was a farmer. She came from the field and doing whatever work she has to do, no gadgets or no nothing, came to do namaskar, and he said, "Amma, I'm very hungry, can you get me something to eat?" So that lady ran home with the, wood and chula. She prepared the thing, chapati, something like that, and came with great hurry and in a plate gave it to him. "Baba, eat." Without taking a single bite, he took that plate and kept it near where there was a dog. And an unknown dog, and he was wagging the tail. So, the moment the dog came, this great master gave it to him, and the dog was enjoying. This lady got angry. "You told me you are hungry, you made me run, and see you are giving it to a dog, not taking even one bite." He said, "Be cool." He said, "The principle of hunger is common for all. If you are living that principle of hunger, then alone you can feel the pangs of hunger in the hungry stomachs. This is called as merging with the totality. When we thus merge with the totality, it is something like this. Our body a totality, and in our body there are so many different parts. Hands are not the legs, legs are not the stomach, stomach is not the back. They are different. But there is a unison, there is no differentiation that the left hand is impure, right hand is pure. No. Because everywhere there is a common factor, the I. In the same manner, when we discover the whole world is nothing but the same principle of life that is pulsating in and through everything, then equanimity becomes natural. We don't have to struggle. We don't have to prove anything to anybody. See? If we don't understand this principle, then we'll start finding out only the faults. Like one of his devotees, all the time hanging around him. So he told him, "You go to that mountain and do sadhana there. Go from here." He said, "No, I can't live without you. I want to be all the time with you." He said, "You get out. I'm fed up of you. Go." So when he pushed him out, do you think he had a hatred for him? And when he gave food to the dog, do you think he had love for him? No. He knows what is right for whom. Name dveshasti na priya. And the same person, when he goes over there, then he comes to realize that I was taking that great master to be a person, to be a body, to be limited in that body. After having gone to that mountain, he comes to know that the great master is available beyond the limitation of time, space and object. This realization, when one has, with that experience, when we start living, that life is called as the life of Jivan Mukta. And this is what is demonstrated in the life of Bhagwan Rama every moment. See, friends. Therefore, Jivan Mukti is not something like an object that is given. Jivan Mukti is not something that we can label somebody, we can evaluate somebody. No. We have to get inspirations from the guidance from the lives of such great characters in our scriptures like Rama, Krishna, etc. See? Therefore, if we study Ramayana and study the charitra of Rama, you will come to know that the greatness of his life was, his mind was never colored or disgusted because of anything. Dukkheshu anudvigna manaha. When miseries came, he did not become miserable. Sukheshu vigataspruhaha. When all comforts were there, he was not attached to the comforts, both the things. Getting influenced by the miseries and getting attached to the comforts will bind us to this world. The wise man, Jivan Mukta, is the one, whether he was living in the palace of his father or he was in the forest, only with the tree bark as his clothes. And yet, everywhere he was at peace. This dependence on the external things, when it reduces to the zero, then a Jivan Mukta is born. None of the things in this world should enslave us. There is a shloka in Mahabharata, Sarvam Paravasham Dukkham, Sarvam Atmavasham Sukham, Etad Vidyat Samasena Lakshanam Sukadukkayoho. All dependence is misery, all independence is freedom. The reason why Bhagavan Rama was not miserable in spite of everything, because he was not dependent on the comforts, nor he was influenced by the disturbances or the miseries of life. Therefore, he was at peace with himself. No, Swamiji, there is a story in Ramayana, you might not have read, that when Sitaji was taken away by Ravana, Rama was crying like, you know, a most miserable husband. And to the trees and the plants and the animals, he was asking, "Oh dear plants, have you seen my Sita? I cannot live without her." That is also a part of Rama's character. How do you say that he was not disturbed and all that? See? For that, the topic which he, Bhagavan Rama, learned from Vasishtaji was, he has realized this world is an appearance. It doesn't exist. So when something is an appearance and doesn't exist, example, drama. In the drama, everything is happening. Friends are there, enemies are there, gain is there, loss is there. Everything is happening on the stage. But is anything ever happening? This was his perfect understanding. Therefore, all that he was just acting. Therefore, the word used in our language is Rama Leela, Krishna Leela. Leela means what? A drama. It appears as if something is happening. Like, you know, on the drama, don't you see that one girl comes, one boy comes, they look at each other, they exchange the flowers, because both of them are fools. See? Though they exchange flowers, they are fools. So, I love you, I love you. Do you think they love each other? No, it's just a drama. See? You follow this principle of drama, you have learned Jivan Mukti, what Bhagavan Ramachandra ji lived. Swamiji, how can we do this drama? It is not possible. Don't tell me that. What are you doing now? As if listening to change. So many Mahatmas have come and gone. Asangoham, asangoham, asangoham punah punah. I am untouched by the wisdom. Let any flood of wisdom comes, Nothing touches me. So as we listen to Vedanta, exactly the same way you listen to the worldly things. You have understood everything. Jivan Mukta. See? Vedanta tells us, you are Brahman. The world tells us, you are a fool. Why do you call me fool? See? When we are told you are divine, we don't agree. But when we are told you are devil, we agree. Because the question is not that we agree. Our objection is, how come Swamiji also knows? See, friends. Therefore, do not imagine Jivan Mukti means becoming weird. See, like me. With a beard, look weird by Jivan Mukta. No. It has nothing to do. Whether you are brahmachari or a grihastha or a vanaprastha or a sannyasi or any human being, doesn't matter. If this quality of life is lived, you are a Jivan Mukta. See, friends. For this, you don't have to have any particular brand. It is a generic product. There is no brand value attached to it. And how the second part of Bhagwan's life, that although he lived in the forest, gone through many difficulties, how his Jivan Mukti was still uncorrupted till he came back. What was the secret? That secret of Jivan Mukti we'll try to explore from his drama that is he played in the forest during the exile tomorrow. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnaat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.